So again, I'm focusing on the junctions between, in this case, the floors and the walls. So I'm going to look a little bit at slab edges to start with, which again, I think you've done quite a bit before, but I'll just touch on that so that we can make them a bit deeper. And you can see in this case it's 450 by 150 slab edge that's been put there. I'm going to delete it, and just so I can go over the process of adding it again, but again, this hopefully is good vision. So I'm going to go to a 3D view, and my floor is still selected. So I can go then down to this temporary hide isolate and just isolate element and see the floor by itself, which makes it a little bit easier to put the slab edge on. And we can also see if it's the right shape for our footings. And then I'm going to do my usual thing to test out the profile that I want to use. I'm going to open it, and I always like to do that rather than just loading it in without knowing what's there. So I'm going to go and browse to my folder that I've given you. And sorry, do you want me to take your screens over? Sorry, I meant to do that. Yes, yeah, yes, sure. Okay, so I'm just opening a file, and I'll remind you of that because this is an easy step to miss, and I do it a lot. So instead of going to open and choosing one of these options, I'm just going to click where it says open, and that way you'll see down here it's going to open all supported files. So that makes it easier. I don't have to know what sort of file I'm trying to open. And I'm then just going to find a slab edge profile that's similar to what I want. So that looks pretty good. But I want it to be deeper. So I'm going to try and use a parameter for that. So I'm going to use the aligned dimension there. Just draw one in, place it to the side, and it's telling us that we can't see that in this view. So, do you want a shortcut for opening up your visibility settings? VV. It's a great one to remember. Yeah, copy to that. So, you can also go back to the view properties. This is a good thing to know as well. When you're in a family, it doesn't default to show the view properties. So, you often have to just choose it from the list there. And then you can click Edit to bring up the dialog box. But again, VV. It's the same thing. And then annotation categories, and you can see the dimensions are hidden. And so our reference planes, so I'll just turn those back on, and there are my dimensions. So they already had a parameter for thickness, so I don't even need to have the one I've added. And we can, of course, just adjust the thickness using that parameter. So to make that available when I load this family, I'm going to go to family types and just check there to see what's available. It's actually got the one I wanted for 900 by 450. Again, that's why I always like to open up these files and check them out before I use them. And so I will just show you how to make a new one if you want it. You can click on the new type there, and we'll make this 900 by 500. And then just change that thickness to 500. And that's working really well. So you can always flip between those different sizes just to make sure they all work. And so you can all get to it, I'll just save this file and modify the one in the library. And oh my god, they've made that drive read only for me. Okay, I'll have to save it with a new name. Slab edge thickened one. You'll see that in the library, and now I can load into project and tick the file I'm working on. And so now back to my 3D view, and because I isolated by element rather than by category, I'll be able to see the slab edge as I place it. So here you're just going to floor slab edge, edit type. And then I'm going to duplicate this one, and we'll just call it anything. I like to put CC before my families because my business name was Color Caddy, so that's just what I do. So CC, and I'm going to make it 450 by 900. And then from the list of profiles there, you can see that it's got the different sizes loaded along with that family. So that's the family slab edge thickened one, and then you've got the sizes that get loaded with it. And that's it. While I'm at it, I can set a material. So I would make a new, simpler concrete. I don't like this chew concrete because it's green, mainly. So I'm going to duplicate that and call it again CC concrete DA. So that's our DA concrete development application. And then I'm going to go to appearance, and yeah, I'll make a much nicer concrete than this. That one's ugly, so I'm going to right click, replace, and then go to the appearance library, and I'll show you a really good one. If you go to here, and the flat grey one, I think is really good. So with these, if you haven't used this much, you just double click on the one you want. You might not see a change, but then when you close the asset browser, you'll see it's loading. So the reason I like this one is because I like that image file that it uses, and I know I can make it look good. So if I click on the image swatch there, so not green, that's right, exactly, yeah, well, it's got a greeny tinge, but yeah, it's not the whole, yeah, fluorescent green yet. So I like to oversize it, so I'm going to make it say at least 1200 wide, and the height whatever it turns out to be. So, oh yes, I did, yeah, 1200, yep, you're right, yep. That's better, so yeah, that's good. And then, that's great, so yeah, that's what I'm watching. So then I also like to put some reflectivity on concrete. This is more for later when we get into rendering, but we can set it up now. So the trick with reflectivity, if it's not a glossy, if you just want, say, reflective concrete, so which is a bit glossy, you want the direct reflections to be about half the oblique. I don't want to spend too long on this, but I'll explain that all later. So trust me, if you just follow that one. Yeah, well, this is going to give us polished concrete. Yeah, but I'll explain all of that later when we get into materials. So for rendering and all the walkthrough stuff we're going to do. So for now, though, that's a good rule of thumb. Direct about half the oblique, and then make sure your glossiness is set to something above zero. And that'll give you good concrete, and the bumps you don't have to worry about. So, oh yeah, then back to graphics. Most of the reason I did the appearance is so I can just go back to graphics now and tick use render appearance. The surface pattern, I'm not going to worry about, even though the colour's set to green, that won't have an effect because there's no pattern there, and then the cut pattern is actually pretty good. So I'm happy with that. And then now, I can just pick the edges, and with any luck, you can use chain to get them all in one hit. And it doesn't like it, so there must be a problem with this edge. Let's see. Yeah, the others are okay. And sometimes tab or chaining the floor with slab edges seems to cause some problems, so you might have to pick them all. Okay, and now, and then you can see I've missed one and it's bumped me off it. So when that happens, just make sure you select the slab edge that you've made and go back to add remove segments to keep selecting them. Otherwise, I'll show you what will happen if you go to make a new one. So if I instead go back to floor slab edge and then choose the edge there, can you see how it's not, well, it's actually done a pretty good job, but sometimes it won't join properly, and they are separate objects. So this one here is separate to the rest of all one connected piece. So it's better if they're like that, so I'll delete this one, and then again select the one I've made before, add remove segments, and just keep going around, and it's all one continuous slab edge. Now you just need to be aware that in reality we're going to have some ground beams, which essentially are going to follow a similar profile that go right over or through this slab. We'll add those later, show you some good tricks for that. But otherwise that's the slab edge done on the basement slab. So I'll reset the view, and is this one you use a lot, the sunglasses to hide and unhide?
Yeah.
Oh, it's a great thing. Yeah, because the normal hide that you get by right-clicking and going to hide and view elements or category, that's a separate system. So you can leave the things hidden that you've hidden before, and then just use this as a temporary hide and unhide. It's just an extra way of hiding. It's a separate system, so that's really useful. And so then in section
That
view,
has a short
it does, yeah, HH.
Yeah,
Yeah, HH is this one, whereas EH is the other type of hide, yeah. So yeah, that's good. And so, okay, so there, it's actually me being too quick. I've chosen the old one, but we can easily now just go back to the one that I'd made earlier. If they'd, yeah, this is a problem actually. So with Revit, without the patch, you often won't get families or types that you've actually loaded. So yeah, that's a big issue. And yeah, I'll just make it again, even
that's
though.
it there. So you see one.
Oh yeah, it is there. Sorry, I'm just blind. Okay, so it is there. So I just want to see. I'm just going to cancel that and see. Oh yeah, it did come up on the list. Okay, I just was blind. Ah, so it didn't like it. Okay, so that's interesting. So it's not going to work with that. Okay, we'll just use a different one. But it should work. Okay, so what we'll have to do, this is a good trick as well, go to edit type, choose it here, and then I can change it to one of the other sizes. I think it's just too big for the corners. So we'll have to try one of the smaller ones. And yeah, okay, so it's because some of those lengths aren't going to work with that size footing. But at least this one's bigger than what we had before, and so that's better. And then the footings, again, I don't want to go too much further than this at this point, but the footings now go past the foundation. And then also the yeah, well that's our pad, that's what we're using for the foundation. So I'm just going to use the arrow key and nudge that down so that at least we've got the topo surface going down below the footing. And I should just make that click because this is something, honestly, for after I graduated, I did mix those up for a long time and wasn't clear about the difference between footings and foundations. So make sure that's something you're all clear about. That's a footing. The foundations are the things under your footings. The gravel.
Ground.
Yeah, the ground, that's right. Generally the hardcore, the gravel and the sand. Yeah, that's right, yeah, exactly. So it would be blue metal, most likely in this case, and then the sand. So this pad that is sand, it's not bad as a starting point, but what I'd be doing is hiding that now. Just hide and view elements. And then, I won't show you how to do this, but I'm sure you'll have an idea. Using filled regions, I would then draw the shape of the foundations under the footings and hatch that in properly. We'll come back to that though. And you could use that for all of the ground surface because you can see here it's not showing up, mostly because of all the topo surface sub-regions. And I should just actually, while we're there though, show you, in case you've forgotten, that you get to the site settings on massing and site to set that earth material that should be coming up. And it's set to have this solid fill. We can't even see that though, so there's some issue there with that display. You'd normally have that set to earth anyway. But like I was saying, you end up redoing most of that with a filled region. So we can have a look at how you can get, you know, to get the 45 degree earth pattern to come in. Okay, so we'll have a look at that anyway. I'll come back to that. So for now, I'll just set the right angle one, which is okay. You can see there it's actually coming up at least, but we can definitely make that much better. But what I really wanted to get into was really tidying up these junctions. So what do you reckon the main issue there with this wall and the floor? Well, what's the basic rule for graphics with your heavy lines? Where do you have your
Oh,
heavy lines?
well, it doesn't have a cross hatch.
Oh yeah, it should be hatching, but I've set the display to coarse so that, yeah, so if I go back to find and get the hatch and the materials, we've got the line there between them because the materials are different, so that's definitely a problem. But for the DA, you could actually have it on coarse and have a solid fill, as long as you know that there's a cavity or whatever's going to go in later. But the basic
so
fill. Oh yeah, but I'd fix that. I'd make them the same in the end.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, definitely. No, no, not on purpose. That's just how they. Yes. Oh, absolutely. Yeah, definitely. For sure. For sure. Yeah. Yeah, yeah. So that's right. Yeah. So that's good because the line only comes up because they're different materials. So if I make this floor now have the same concrete I just made, then yeah. So that but it's good to notice that because that's a really important thing. But that's not what I was getting at. So my material. Yep. So I'll just search because of the dashes. They always throw out the order. There's mine. So then now we'll lose the line.
Yay.
So that's good. Yeah. But that's not the main issue. The main issue is that you should only have a heavy line on the outer part of the thing that's been cut. So there shouldn't be a heavy line here. I know it seems like a petty thing, but it's a big thing. Any architect is going to pick you up on that straight away. So, because that's the way you're trained. Yeah. The cut line represents the envelope of what's being cut. The heavy line is the outer edge of what's being cut. So that's the basis of all architectural graphics, basically. So to get rid of that, it's simple. Join. Join geometry. Yeah, I'll save it. And so now if I choose this wall, and the floor, I know it seems like a simple thing, but it's so important. And so here we go. Wall, floor, bingo. And it's just got a light line. When you go to course, you don't even see that. And honestly, a DA can be like that. They don't need to see the materials. As long as they know in the elevation what the finishes look like, that's all they care about. Yeah, or no, even if they're different materials altogether. If it's in course, yeah, so you know, oh yeah, now I should remind you about course because a lot of people don't know this. When you look at any system family, so that's walls, floors, slab edges, anything like that, you'll have this coarse scale fill colour. So that's where this colour is being set. And that's the one thing I really like about most of Max's families, the Chu families, is that they have this 128, 128, 128 grey set for the coarse fill colour for most things. So the walls and the floors all come up the same colour for your DAs, and that's all you need. Your roofs, everything like that. Oh, now, not slab edges, sorry, I should have said roofs, ceilings, floors, and walls. Slab edges will pick up the colour, but only because they're joined to the floor. If you look at the slab edge properties, it doesn't actually have that coarse option, but it will pick it up from the floor. And so coming up to here, all we've got to do now is just join this floor to the wall, and it's already looking a whole lot tidier. So they're not intersecting, that's fine, but all of these things, slab edges can be joined to other things. There we've got a different colour, but I'll show you the trick. Once this floor is joined to the other one, that must be again because that slab edge is a different material. I can fix that. And so then again, you'll get these annoying little lines coming through, but you just keep joining away. And so maybe the final thing I'll show you there is how to use multiple join, because it took me a few goes to get it working. Essentially, once you go to join, and then you tick multiple join. So let's just find a good example. Yeah, okay, so maybe I've got to show you the roof, even though I wanted to go to roof next week, but we'll just show you that with multiple join. So you tick multiple join. And then, yeah, it's just this roof's joining multiple things. So I'll choose the roof, and then I've got to choose all the things I want to join to that. So you choose one element, and then the multiple join is the second thing you choose, where you can choose as many things as you want to join to that one initial element. So you can go like this, crossing across all these things, and it's going to come up and say 19 of those things don't intersect or don't join, don't touch the thing I'm trying to join to. Great, I'll unjoin them. But everything else that I've chosen that does touch the roof will join. That's it. So that's the key. If you want to use multiple join, just realizing that you're still starting with one object, and then you can attach this board, join as many things as you want to that. And so, yeah, so there you can see, much cleaner, and we really just need a ceiling to make this start to, you know, get towards being a finalized view or section. We've got lots of things on the interior to tidy up, like the kitchens and little things like that. So it'll be a good chance to go back into families. But aside from that, you just want to be focusing on the sections now and making sure that their graphics is coming together. Just remember, you've got the two sections, that's all, just the long and the short. I don't care which one you call which, because the building's almost square shaped, so they'll be a similar length, I think. But do you have an idea? This, I probably would say, is the short, the cross section, and the other one's the long section, but it doesn't matter.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, now, while I'm at it, the great new option with Revit 2019, you can join stairs to floors now. So not sorry, 2018. I think you can. So I'm using 2019 so much I forget if it's in this one, but let's just test it. So if I choose the stair, yes, you can. I know it seems like a little thing, but we've been waiting for this for like 15 years. Yeah, there's, oh, that's okay. So Elise actually, she's the same trick as me. Yeah, I do that all the time. Yeah, that's a good trick. So if you've done that, that's great. Putting an extra floor on top, it's a brilliant idea, because then you can get your junctions right at bathrooms and things where the tiles do step up and are a different height to the, maybe your floating timber floor or whatever's next to it. So that's a really good trick. So, I know, they should be, but in reality, there might be slight differences. Or if you want them flush, then you've got to get your packing different, so that's good. But you can show that. And it's mainly, it's also so you get the floor junctions, because, not floor, the wall junctions, because the walls will go down to your structural floor, and then rather than letting Revit work it out, which it will do, if you get all your layers right in your floors, it'll do the junctions for you, and you don't need these extra floors that stack on top of the structural floor. But it's easier, just like Elise has shown you, to put a floor on top. And God, I thought I'd worked that one out and no one else knew it, but she obviously, great minds. No, she would have worked it out. It's just a logical thing that you work out after using it for a while. And so here it's telling me I'm choosing the wrong floor and they're not intersecting. So I'll go to thin lines and see where my problem is and see if I can... Oh yes, because it's... Well, okay, so this is where you need to make an adjustment. So I'm glad I saw this, because there we've got this floor, which is the finished floor level, and it's, what, 20 metres, 20 mil above. So technically that stair should come up, and I won't tell you, well, I will tell you the way they do it in real life. They build it to the structural floor, and they tile up, or they do some sort of packing on top of each step. And they've even been on jobs where they have to incrementally pack less and less as they go to the next floor, because the packing on the next floor is less than the one on the ground floor. And there's no other choice, because you've got the structural floor there, and that goes in at the same time as the stair. So that's how they work the heights out. Yeah, exactly, if it's concrete, and this would be. So then if you've got different finished floor levels on the two floors, what do you need? Hope you've got a certifier, or let you off with a few mil difference between your risers, which some will. Most won't though, because that's a really important thing for trip hazards. So yeah, I've been on jobs where literally they do fractions of a millimetre adjustments as they pack on each step. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Even the private guys, they're not going to certify it these days unless they want to lose their licence. Yeah. Unless you get one who's pretty brave, but no, not anymore. Or maybe not the guys I know. But I'm not a... to get along with them. So, let me know if there's anything you want me to look at, but otherwise that should be pretty good. So, yeah. Yep. And yeah, don't be afraid to, even in DA drawings, tidy it up in 2D using all your annotation tools, filled regions, detail lines, any of those. you need to, and I can't help myself, there is just one last thing I want to make sure you know. Line work tool. You know about that one? Okay, so if you've got a line that isn't right, and you just want to change it, so can I see one? Yeah, so maybe here, there's an extra line. That's probably a section. So that's not a great example, but maybe maybe here. So that's a fascia that's sticking out, and I don't want it to look like that. So if you go to the line work tool, you can choose any line style there. So we could change it to a thinner or a thicker line, or just as an example, maybe we want to make it invisible. So you can go to invisible lines and just hide them. And that's a great thing for tidying up. It really will help a lot once you get to finalise these drawings. Let's go to an example. Oh yeah, yeah, yeah. Okay, so you go back to by category. So back to here, and why can't I see by category? So by category sets it back to the initial state. So I've already done that, but I'll just do it again. So say we've done invisible lines, and yes, this has all been modelled pretty cleanly, but often you will get lines between walls and other things. Well there, here, so this one, mate, you don't want to see that line. So you go, right, I want to make that invisible. And there we are. So there are a few lines there, I just had to click a few times.
That already changed that entirely.
In that view, that's right, yep. It is, yep, view specific. Yeah. So it's cheating in a way, but it does what you need it to. So there, maybe we don't want to see that one either. And I thought, oh my god, actually those things were things I wanted to see. So, to put it back, it's by category. And then you can find the lines and set it back to the way they were. Yeah. But that's a great thing to know, because you see a lot of people will, you know, put masking regions over their lines and all these things just to hide a line. Yeah, yeah. But once you know about that one, you can override any line in any view. Works in 3D views, any view at all. Yeah. So hopefully that wasn't too long. I'm trying to get them under 10 minutes. I think it was a bit over, but hopefully that's all right.